Hello, in this video we will complete the discussion of section 2.2 of Kasumu's book, Introduction to Stochastic Processes. In the previous videos of section 2.2, we have introduced the idea of a continuous time, discrete state Markov process. We've given one particular example of such a process called the Poisson process. Now we give some general definitions. Here we have the definition of a time homogeneous, this should not say Markov chain, it really should say Markov process. Now a stochastic process, this just means a sequence of random variables with index t, where t is a continuous index. That means I could have x of 0.73, x of 0.81. For every continuous value, I have a different random variable. But this process is said to be a Markov process with state space omega. If for any m and n, which are non-negative numbers, and j in omega, for the Poisson process, the omega was equal to the positive real numbers, which I can write n plus, the natural numbers. Okay. So here is my property. Now be careful here. In your book, this looks like a minus. It should be a plus. This is a plus. So if it's not clear, please correct that. It should be a plus. So this is the probability that x of m plus n equals j, given x sub t, where t is less than or equal to m, is equal to the probability of x of m plus n equals j, given x sub m. What is going on here? Well, let's draw a number line. Here we have a number line. Here we have m, and here we have n plus m. Okay. Now, in this region, we have t less than m. Okay? So this is saying that if I know all the values of x of t, where t is less than or equal to m, the only information that matters is the value of x at m. Okay? So the process at time n plus m only depends on the process at m and not additionally on the previous time. So this is just like the Markov chain . Okay, so the probability of a state at time n plus 1 only depends on the probability of the state at the previous time. So the probability of state at n plus 1 depends on the probability of the state at time n. If you remember, to get the probability of the state at time n plus 1, you take all the probabilities of all the states at time n and multiply them by the transition probabilities. It does not depend on previous probabilities. So this property of a Markov process comes directly from the fact that a Markov process is a limit of a Markov chains. Additionally, if the quantities in this equation are independent of m, then the process is said to be time homogeneous. So you really shouldn't say 2.9 is independent of m. What you should say is the probability of x of m plus n equals j given x of m. If this probability is independent of m, then the process is said to be time homogeneous. Now this follows in our case from the fact that the transition probabilities are constant. Your transition probabilities came from a transition matrix. And that matrix did not change from time to time. Every time to get the next state, you would multiply by the same transition matrix. So in the continuous time Markov process, you still have probabilities that do not change. And this comes because such a continuous time, a time homogeneous Markov process comes from a single transition matrix for a discrete Markov chain. So as an example, the book tells you that the Poisson process is time homogeneous. And this should be clear because it comes from a Markov chain with a fixed transition matrix. Now, the way you can see that is the probability of x of m plus n equal j given xm equal I. How can you get from state I at time m to state j at time m plus n? All right, so what is meant by events here? Event means a transition from state k to k plus 1. All right, I'm starting in state I, and I need to make j minus I jumps from I to I plus 1 to I plus 2 to I plus 3, etc. To get to j, I must have made j minus I of these jumps. And these jumps must have occurred during the time interval n, because we're starting at time m and moving to m plus n. So we have a time interval of length n. Okay? So that means j minus I events occurring in time n, this shouldn't be ij here, this should be j minus I. So the way we write j minus I jumps in the time interval n, that has probability, this should actually be a j minus I here. If you look back, this is our notation for j minus I transitions in the time interval n. We can see that back up here. Remember, P1 of t was equal to the probability of being in state 1 at time t. So in this case, we're looking for the probability of being in state j minus I at time n. So in order to get our expression for the probability of transition, we simply replace the previous expression, t gets replaced with n, and n gets replaced with j minus I. So replace this from the previous equation. Okay, my time interval is n, and my state is j minus I. There's the same probability of going from state I to state j, as there is from going to from state 0 to state j minus I. Because in both cases, you need to have j minus I jumps. Okay? Now, since this expression does not depend on m, this is a time homogeneous Markov process. It depends only on the time interval n and the difference between the two states. Now, what we've been studying is related to the exponential distribution that you may have studied in other courses. Let t represent the time until we observe the first Poisson event. Now, what's a Poisson event? That's a transition from state 0 to state 1. Okay. Now, if you remember, we calculated the probability of remaining in state 0 at time t. That was this probability here, e to the minus lambda t. Now, if there is a transition before time little t, that means that the process is not in state zero. Okay, so that's the relationship between this event, capital T less than or equal to T, and the event that the chain remains in state zero at time T. Okay, so this is the probability that the chain remains in, I'll just say, in the original state. F of t is the probability that the process does not remain in the original state. E to the minus lambda t is the probability that the chain does remain in the original state. These are complementary probabilities. So in fact, F of t is equal to 1 minus e to the minus lambda t. Okay. So let me just write that. We have capital F of t is equal to 1 minus e to the minus lambda t. Now, what about little f of t? This is the density. The density is the derivative of the distribution function. Okay? It's an easy exercise to show that the derivative of this capital F is equal to this function here. Now we have the multiplicative property of exponentials. If we take the exponential of the sum of two terms, that's equal to the product of the exponentials of the individual terms. So this complementary distribution function is the product of the two individual complementary distribution functions. Okay, so that's what we have here, which we can rewrite this way. And we can rewrite this in terms of the event probability. The complementary probability, we remember we had F of t is equal to the probability that t is less than or equal to t. And we have F complementary probability is the probability that t is greater than t. So this top probability is equal to the probability that t is greater than t plus s. This bottom probability is the probability that t is greater than t. Since the top event is contained in the bottom event, the ratio of probabilities is simply the conditional probability. So that's how we get this conditional probability. It's because the top event is contained in the bottom event. Okay. And here we simply have the complementary probability of S is probability T greater than S. Okay. So here we can see that this probability on the left is independent of T. In other words, if I have my number line and I have T and T plus S, and I want the probability of an event in this interval, it does not depend on T. So any interval has the same probability of an event. So this property is called the memoryless property because it doesn't depend on the past. It doesn't depend on anything that happened before T. Sometimes people say that light bulbs follow this distribution. It doesn't matter how long your light bulb has been working, it will have the same probability of going bad at any time. That's because light bulbs often go bad because of current surges or other reasons like this, which do not depend on the lifetime of the light bulb. Now we can make an alternative definition of a Markov process, which is what he is talking about here. Okay. Suppose you have a process that stays at state J and stays for a random length of time before moving to state K with probability PJK. Okay. So let me just compare this to Poisson. In Poisson, you can only go from J to J plus 1. For a more general Markov process, you could go from state J to some other state K. Okay. We could specify also a transition matrix with entries PJK. So these are transition matrix entries. So this is a more general process than the Poisson process. The Poisson process can only go from a state to the state with the next index. A more general Markov process could go from one state to any other state. So this quantity here has the interpretation. There is a transition from state J before time t, and the transition is made to state K. There's a transition before time T, and the transition is made to state K. So this expresses the probability that the transition is before T, and this expresses the fact that the transition is from J to K. And this is the definition of QJK, where QJK of T is equal to the probability that the process is in state K at time T, given that it starts in state J at time 0. Okay. Now, since the process must be in some state K at every time, the sum of these Qs must be equal to 1. Right. Now, the assumption is that this Fj is a memoryless random variable, so it has an exponential probability distribution. Right. So this is more general theory, and we may use this later to construct some stochastic process. Okay.